Eating and drinking are permitted, but we ask that you treat our theater as you would your own living room. On second thing, please deposit all trash in the waste bins. Thank you. As a courtesy to our presenters and everyone else in the theater, refrain from flash photography and turn off or silence your cell phones. Also, we ask that there be no texting during the presentation. The texting lamp is on. And now, Stage 28 and Walt Disney Imagineering are pleased to present a good look at Buena Vista Street, sneaking a peek at the new entrance to Disney California Adventure. Please welcome Imagineers Lisa Girolami, Ray Spencer, and Coulter Winn.
I think we're on.
Can you hear me?
Good.
Wow, thank you. Gosh, there are a lot of people here. So how many people have been to Disney California Adventure? How many people haven't? All right, I guess we're ready to roll then. I wanted to introduce everybody to, I know we just got introduced, but from my far right, we have Coulter Winn, who for Buena Vista Street, what we'll be talking about today, is the concept architect. And also, to my right, my nearest right, is Ray Spencer, who is the concept designer for Buena Vista Street as well. And then I'm the show producer, which is more like mom. They come to me and say, can I have some money? And I give them money.
But, yeah, I
wouldn't
remember that.
Okay, good, good. Oh, boy. And the reason I say that is it certainly does take a team, and I am certainly honored to be on this team. These two gentlemen next to me are some of the best that we have at Imagineering, and it's certainly an honor, and it's very exciting to talk about what we're doing at Disney California Adventure. So, how many people are sick of the construction fences?
Woo!
Yeah, I kind of figured. Well, they're going to be up for another year, so get used to them. We're just changing them around a lot. But obviously, the reason those fences are up is for good reason. We've seen, we just finished up Paradise Pier, and all those fences are down. Yay. And we're bringing you new things. You know, Walt said, you know, we never finish around here. We're always working on something, and that we take to heart. And before we get into this, I just want to give you a little background on what we're doing and what this presentation is about. About four and a half years ago, the group of us got, you know, together and said, okay, we're going to do this expansion of Disney California Adventure. And what does that mean? What that meant in a very general sense is, what can we do to the park to make it better, to, you know, make it connect more with the guests, and also make it make more sense in terms of where you are, why you're there, what you're doing. And, you know, there's always room for improvement, even in the best rides, the best attractions, the best shows. There's always room for improvement. But what we did is we said, we're going to take certain parts of the park, and we're going to do what we can to tie it in better. And we're going to get into more detail about what that means, but very, very simply, it means making a stronger emotional connection, just like, we do at Disneyland, walking into Main Street. And that we're going to talk in much more detail about, because we want you to walk into Disney California Adventure and feel that same emotional connection. And the other thing is we wanted to introduce more of our characters into Disney California Adventure. You've seen it already with Mickey Mouse on the Silly Symphony Swings, of course, Ariel in the Little Mermaid ride, Goofy Sky School, the Toy Story, you know, Midway Mania characters. So we're starting to really bring a lot of those characters back in. That's what works. That's what we all love. So there's, in the most general sense, those are the things that we're doing. Working on, you know, sense of place and time, the emotional connection, characters, and bringing it all together the way we love to do for the guests. So I'm going to hand it over first to Ray Spencer, and we're going to go through these awesome slides. You're probably going to see some pictures you've never seen before as well. So you're the first.
All right. So we'll start with the Buena Vista Street overview here. Our main streets around the world created emotional resonance, as the slide says here. the number of people that have told us over the years that once they arrive on Main Street, they feel like they're home. They feel like it's a safe place. They've left their everyday cares behind, and we're in a world that's magical and new and safe and fun and family-oriented. And, you know, that's one of the elements, that's one of the DNA elements that we've really emphasized here in creating Buena Vista Street. It's a very important aspect of the parks that we design, and we felt that, first and foremost, that's what we need to create that sense of home and that sense of warmth and that sense of belonging that our main streets typically create. Looking at the entrance here, we're just starting to zoom in on the Buena Vista Street overview, which Coulter will be diving into in a few minutes. If we look at the name of the street, Optimism and Opportunity, Buena Vista means good view, and it's also, for most of you that probably know this, the street that our studios are located on in Burbank, and where Walt built the studios after the success of Snow White, using the money that was made from that film. So that really gave us the opportunity to pay homage to that element, and not only that, the fabulous story of Walt and his arrival in California. He arrived in 1923 from Kansas City, $40 in his pocket, a cardboard suitcase, and an extreme sense of optimism and opportunity that, you know, he looked forward to in creating a life out here in movie production, animation production, and developing the studios. Walt Disney, for a lot of people, unknown to some of us, and excuse me for a second, I'm just getting tongue-tied here. For a lot of people, now we're doing some research and we're finding out that some people don't understand that Walt Disney was a real person. They think of it as a corporate name. So it's important for us to go back and really kind of tell the story of this remarkable person and this remarkable journey and these pioneering efforts and the risks he took. And so for us, Buena Vista Street gives us the opportunity to complete that bookend. If Main Street was Walt's romanticized hometown of Marceline, Missouri, then this is the second part of his life. This is when he came out to California, a young man, full of optimism, and our Main Street, our Buena Vista Street from 1923 when he arrived to 1937 where the Carthay Circle Theater is, that's a period of time when all of these pioneering efforts were made, and we had culminating with the premiere of Snow White, which of course became a tremendous success and really gave us the birth of our company and gave us really the opportunity to all be here today. So we feel this is a really important story, and that's what we're concentrating on in this Main Street. So I'd like to turn it over to Coulter Winn now, who's going to go ahead and get into the plans and the architecture and really how we manifested this street for you.
Well, some of you visited the model yesterday, and I was fortunate enough to be able to talk to a few of you. And what we're really doing with the street is making it work in the way that Disneyland's Main Street works, in terms of we've expanded it out to into the Esplanade a bit, as you can see with the new turnstiles. And it gives you a place to decompress and sort of, you know, we're creating some opportunities for, I think this laser works. So the new turnstiles are out here. And so this is works like Town Square at Disneyland, where you can begin to, you know, pick up those things that you need, the water, the sunscreen, various things, so you can get your family together and then begin your journey from there. And the street is really divided into a couple of zones. This is much like Los Feliz or Atwater Village, small town communities where Walt spent his early years. And we've got the Hyperion Bridge, which is where the former Golden Gate Bridge was. And that divides the street where now we've got more of the Los Feliz, Wilshire Boulevard area. One thing that's really important is the new fountain and hub, Carthay Circle, has been offset from the street. And you can see that on the plan. And that was very important because now you can be at the fountain and not be able to see the Disneyland train station. It's one of the problems that the existing entry had was you were not in an immersive environment. You could always look around and figure out you really weren't in the story. We don't want you, if you're in Adventureland, we don't want you seeing Tomorrowland. So that same logic sort of works here too. We have to go back and always remember what worked at Disneyland and how we can take those guiding principles and make sure we're applying them here at California Adventure. The Carthay Circle Theater is the icon building at the end of the street, and we're really excited about it. We think it's a complete connection story-wise to the history of the company, and it's going to be a beautiful icon for the park. So this is really a composite, just to show you everything in red. Well, it's all gone now, but you can see the existing previous turnstiles, and now the current turnstiles, the way they've been pulled out, and the way the street has gone through where the former tile mural walls were and the bridge. And now you see, very importantly, the addition of landscape. One of the key messages we got from you, our guests, was that there really weren't enough trees in Disney California Adventure. I mean, palm trees are nice, but they don't do much for you on an August day. So one of the things we're doing is, you can see the model here, it's this large tree. We're creating sort of a California scene where big trees existed before the architecture came in. So, you know, we've all gone around to the small little commercial areas, and you see the big oak tree, and you go, wow, that's 200 years old, and good thing they kind of dodged it. We're creating some of that on Buena Vista Street.
I think, to Coulter's point, California Adventure is full of palm trees that point straight up and into the atmosphere. So your eye is almost taken out of the scene. And part of our goal here with this landscaping and some of the other elements we've designed is to keep your eye down in the scene so you're always in the story. You know, that's a really important aspect of the design. Guest comfort, shade, satisfiers, really solving a lot of the problems that we felt really needed to be addressed in terms of guest comfort and storytelling.
And it's funny that when you are in an environment like a theme park and even out on city streets, the what we call landscape architecture or hardscape, you know, and softscape, it's important and it's needed, and it completes the whole picture. And just as they were saying, trees, certainly for great reasons, they provide oxygen, things like that, and shade, all the creature comforts Ray was talking about, are all really important, but they also soften things as well. And we spend just as much time on the area development, landscaping, what curbs are going to look like if we have curbs, what trees, what, you know, what concrete, what material, if it's not concrete on the floor, you know, on the grounds. And we spend a lot of time with that because it really does tie everything together. And if there's one thing that's just off, you may not see it, you may not even recognize it, but you're going to be aware that something's wrong. And so every single detail we spend many, many, many hours talking about, even down to the selection of trees.
It's really the two main icon buildings that are nostalgic, that are part of the new entry, are the Pan Pacific Auditorium nostalgic turnstiles, as well as the Carthay Circle Theater. And one of the things about Buena Vista Street is none of it exists anywhere else. It's an idealized version of Los Angeles that never existed, with the exception of two of the key pieces of architecture, which are interpretations of pre-existing buildings.
Once you enter the turnstiles, of course, we don't have the berm like Disneyland with the tunnels, so that sense of immersion that's created by the berm, we don't have. Coulter alluded to the hub being off-center and creating that sense of space, but we do have a metaphoric town square at the beginning of this sketch. Again, you're seeing representations of early concept work and later concept work, so it's an amalgam of drawings here. But we've got our own little town square area that will have a red car trolley stop, and as the slide says, red car trolley. and I'm controlling the slide, so these guys kick me. They want me to advance it, so keep your eye on it. The red car trolley, it's a model of a Pacific Electric a trolley that at one time 1,000 miles of track across Southern California from the desert to the mountains to the oceans, and it was used for real estate development, transportation, and I think the last car ran in 1961. So we brought them back at California Adventure. They're being fabricated right now. We have two of them that are in fabrication. Each one will have a different paint job. One will be sort of an as-delivered 1915s-era paint job, and the other will be a later paint job, like you see in the sketch here. They're modeled after the actual, what Pacific Electric called the Hollywood cars, which was a car that a lot of people are familiar with. It's kind of the textbook car you see going down Hollywood Boulevard in old photographs. So that's something we're working on here. So just about every scene that you see in Buena Vista Street will have the red car represented somewhere trundling along the track. So we're pretty excited about that. Not only that, but the overhead wires for the trolley will create another visual cap so that your eyes are down in the scene. We don't want people to look up and out into space here. We really want to get that sense of closure and that sense of a neighborhood that's important to us. Now we'll get into the architectural styling. I'll turn it over to Coulter.
So as we sort of dig into the street, you know, it gets back to focusing on, you know, core Disney lessons. If you take Main Street and you take all the Disney scale and you start to divide up facades of buildings, you have more of a believable and friendlier place. So we did a lot of research and we were looking at a lot of historical photographs. There is one facade here you'll see later. This is the J.J. Newberry facade, where these panels inspired one of our facades. But what we really did is take pieces of buildings, not creating, you know, whole facades. We didn't want you to come and see Buena Vista Street and drive up somewhere in Los Angeles and see the actual building. That would be kind of a letdown. So it was much more difficult to actually reinvent all these facades. And there were five architects involved. My philosophy was that if one person drew the street, it would look the same somehow. So it would be better to turn it over to different sets of hands, and that you would have a more believable product in the end run, that it was actually looked like it was built over time. So when it's open, you can all let me know if that was a successful theory.
Yeah.
Again, we start looking at things, and you start seeing details. They're the posters of the era. Again, you know, detailing and how some of these elements really worked to create that sense of credibility. You know, architecture credibility, that there was a fabrication, there's a love and passion for materials, and there was a lot of hard work that went into these original buildings that somehow always seems to be lost with some of the more contemporary architecture. So we were focused on, you know, the level of quality. The street had to be completely believable. We had to get the quality level up so that it was on par with the rest of our main streets, because otherwise, you know, we wouldn't be doing our job. So.
And I would say, too, that if our story is not credible, if our architecture is not credible, if the details aren't credible, then our story isn't credible, and we've lost our guests and we've lost the story. So That sort of effort and attention to detail is very important to us.
So now we start getting into some development of elevations for buildings. This is, again, an early concept sketch. This is the north elevation of Los Feliz Fine Van Dyne. But you can see that what we're doing now is we're developing a sense of the scale. We're also referencing images from either existing or historical photographs, so we always can check ourselves that we're really creating a place and time with this particular spirit of the architecture that's going to be believable. And we did this as for every facade as we marched down the street, and we did a number of large-scale just facade models to really check ourselves that we were, you know, detailing things appropriately.
And I would say, too, that architectural compression is something that we've used as well, because as you know, on Main Street, the facades are fairly small. If you really step back and look at them, they're romanticized, but they're smaller than an actual building would be. And here, in order to achieve the look and the density that we want, Coulter's done a magnificent job of doing exactly that.
The problem is a little bit different here, because we have existing buildings that we're putting, you know, we're extending, but we're also putting new facades. And so the vertical geometry was a challenge in terms of we had a box that we had to cover, but we had to give it a Disney scale. So we went through a lot of hard work and iterations to bring that scale down to a Disney scale, yet still do the job of adequately cladding all the buildings. This is, again, part of the Elias and Co. facade. This is the east facade, just south of Hyperion Bridge. Again, you can see some of the source inspiration for some of the decoration that's going to go on to this elevation.
As you can see here, we've got thousands and thousands of hours of work in this, and it's important to say that because, you know, we're kind of doing a little bit of everything. We are creating a city street, a number of kind of an amalgam of city streets that have been, you know, seemingly built over time, and creating those layers and creating the different hands of the architects of that period and, you know, what we're doing there. And I'll tell you, again, it's the nth degree. It's going, you know, that extra 1,000 yards to deliver that detail. And I will say, you know, I was joking about the construction fences, and I'll joke until we open. But so when you do walk by these construction fences that are, you know, going up in this area, you have firsthand knowledge now and can spread it around, I hope, you know, of what really is going on back there and why those fences are up and why it's so important, because we have to go all the way with every single little detail from research, you know, inception, all the way through design, all the way through construction and delivery, you know, to bring that to you. So that's why we're saying, you know.
It's a challenge with an operating theme park to do that, and believe me.
We appreciate your patience.
Yeah.
but I'll go back to one slide. I want to talk a little bit about Elias & Co.
Check it out.
Perfect. So this is really sort of our flagship store, Elias & Co. So, again, this is a sketch that Ray did, looking from the fountain. And we took the inspiration from early Los Angeles department stores for this facade right here, which is going to, you know, it's our emporium. And so we developed a lot of the architecture based on some of the early Los Angeles department stores, but it's not any one of them in particular.
And an interesting bit of trivia, Hollywood Boulevard in California Adventure, the buildings there are actual representations of actual buildings. So if you go into Hollywood, you'll see some of those buildings in full size, full scale, and you will recognize them. Buena Vista Street, as Coulter alluded to, as bits and pieces, but you won't recognize any of them because it's an amalgam.
So we started developing color elevations, and this is on the this is the existing restroom facade. The restrooms are here. This facade is completely rebuilt. The lockers are here. This is the J.J. Newbery facade inspiration piece, which you'll see a detail of a little bit later. This is Mortimer's Market. It's like an open-air market. It was based on a building that was on 6th Avenue, and it was torn down in the 1930s in Los Angeles. Had incredible detail. You'll see a little bit of that, and we're recreating it all. And then further down the street, we've got Julius Katz and Sons going down to the candy shop, and then we've got the Fiddler Fife and Practical Cafe in the background. But again, you can see color, there's material, there's a lot of textures, mock-up panels, and samples that we're putting into all of this. This is to the other side of the street. And again, you can see the starting with the north, Oswald's gas station is not shown in this one, but we've got the, this is the guest services and first aid. This is Los Feliz Five and Dime, again, a cross-section through the Hyperion Bridge, and this is the Elias & Co. facade along with the jewelry store. The candy shop's being moved, and the store's going into its place, and on the side of the west side of the street, we're expanding the bakery, so where the train was, we're putting in additional 80 indoor seats for at Fiddler Pfeiffer and Practical Cafe, and Clarabelle's Hand Scoop ice cream is getting a lot larger, so the ice cream shop will be coming back. I got several complaints yesterday about, you know, I was very disappointed when I went up. Sorry.
Yeah.
And we do color boards. We do really extensive color theory. Ray and I had some very interesting conversations with Katie Olson, our color. She's the color queen. I don't know if any of you know of Katie, but she's great. But it's really difficult when you're putting together, you know, an idealized version of a Los Angeles street, but, you know, it's a theme park, and you want to make it a happy place. And, you know, a lot of color starts going on. There's a lot of adjacency issues. And Ray and I were out with Katie once on a 103-degree day with 2x2 color panels, making sure they worked both in sun and shade. And
yeah.
I think the shady conversations were a lot longer than the sunny ones.
Well, you know, we know a fair amount about color. And Katie is really the queen of color. So when we were looking at color for the Carthay Circle, Katie had a color chip. Coulter and I both looked at it, and we both shook our heads like this. She painted a panel. We went outside, looked at it in the sun, and we both shook our heads like this.
It was amazing.
So there's always something to learn. This is an interior shot of one of the shops. In order to bring the fidelity of the outside, we're going to that excruciating degree of detail on the outside. It's very important for us, for credibility's sake, and to tell our story, to bring that to the inside. So all of the shops that you see on Buena Vista Street will have full-finished interiors that reflect and represent the exterior facades. So you will see the same kind of detail that you see here, that you see on Main Street Disneyland, you'll see in those shops, as opposed to what we currently have now. So we're working very hard to make sure that all of this ties together in terms of storytelling and making this a credible place. The other thing about this street that we didn't really address is that, like the Emporium at Disneyland, both sides of our street will have drive aisles through the shops, so that in addition to entering the shops through the front doors, you'll be able to access them through an aisle that runs parallel to Buena Vista Street that's within the shop, so that if you want to stay cool and stay indoors and enjoy the air-conditioned comfort, you'll be able to do that. And we think this is going to allow this park to be much more flexible and much more friendly to our guests.
Another thing we did about the shops, the interior to the exterior, the current entry to California Adventure did not have what I would call a transparent retail envelope. Typically you go into walking along a street, you're going to be able to see through the merchandise displays into the shop. We didn't have that, so we're bringing all that back. We've got a lot of great merchandise displays, but also we have a lot of transparency into the shop. So there is a connection from the exterior of the buildings to the interior. This slide here is just showing a little bit about what we're doing with the detail. We've got a tile factory up local. There's a lot of history to it. They're building mostly all of our decorative tiles, are making them all. And we have one interior designer, Terry, the tile queen. She is...
We have a lot of queens at Imagineering.
A lot of queens. We're just, you know...
Oh, and those queens.
Well, you know, I guess we said, yeah. Okay.
Sorry, only
a D23.
We just got
okay.
Trouble.
The tile expert. Passionate person. Okay. She has taken upon herself as a mission to organize and really track all of the decorative tile on this street. There's like thousands of pieces.
Yeah. And there's over 400 different tile types. And most of them are handmade. So.
And it does have, as Coulter was saying, the tile experts, the people that the artisans actually are working on these tile pieces, building them, have ties back to the 1920s Los Angeles and the tile work that you see there. So we have a number of those instances in Buena Vista Street and the whole entry where there are ties back to the same artisans, the same buildings, and all of that here, which you're going to feel when you walk in the park. You're going to feel that sense. It really will truly be a completely different space and a completely different experience when you walk into the new Buena Vista Street.
There's one little image I just want to point out, because this guy here, that is a sculpt. I mentioned all the sculpting that we're doing for the decorative detail. That is the sculpt that's going over the doorway to the candy shop. That's the mold we're pulling the tool off of. So we've got the plate with the beehive and the two bears trying to get their treat over the entry to
and that's one of how many
a lot of custom pieces.
The architectural ornamentation, which I'm sure Coulter will talk a little bit more about, is amazing. It really is. If, you know, if you're remodeling your house, wouldn't you wish people would do this much research and design on your house?
Well, you know, getting back to the stories again, Coulter, in addition to color, tile is another thing. When we first started this project, you know, we looked at a lot of tile and somebody, project manager, somebody asked, who's going to be responsible for that tile? And Coulter was like, oh, you know, we can do it. Boy, were we wrong. So we have Terry Tile, who's fantastic. And, you know, this is quite an effort, but it's a fabulous thing.
Yeah, that was true. There's a lot of, you learn a lot, and the thing about Buena Vista Street that's really convincing to us, the design team, that it's going to be great, is the amount of work that it takes to get it done. It's like, you know, we were calling it the tar pit job. It just kind of like glommed on you and sucks you in because it's so vast. And the tile is just one thing. The architectural ornamentation is another. And we pre-bought all this stuff. I've been spending a lot of time with the vendor actually, you know, proving all of the ornamentation. A lot of it's already in the warehouse ready to go because we don't want to keep the construction fences up any longer than we have to. So this stuff's going to come out in a big hurry once we really take the street down, I guess, the next September or so.
Yeah. Here's the interior of Clarabelle's. You can see the tile has sort of an ice cream motif. And sometimes when we pick the tile, in this case, I told Terry, I said, make it look like you can lick it. Because we want it to be lickable.
Don't lick it, Emily.
In our candy shop, we picked sort of a Necco wafer tile that has that sort of dusty color.
So, yeah, well, you got to tell the real story about the Necco wafers. There was a real bunch of Necco wafers that we put on the conference table and go, look at this color palette, it's perfect. That's what actually sorry.
I was smarter than that. No, this is a fabulous thing. You can see some of the graphics, if I can back up for a second, you can see some of the graphics starting to appear on these images. Our marquees are being developed right now, so we don't have a lot of representations here. I would like to address the names of the shops, though some people might be curious, because we've got Disney character references in most of them, or Disney locations that were, and street names that were relevant to Walt's Walt's early years in Los Angeles, Kingswell Photo Supply, Los Feliz Five and Dime. Those are areas. Kingswell was where one of the first Disney studios was located. Los Feliz is where Walt hung out. So, you know, we're paying homage to those early Disney years here. You may not see characters all over the place, and you won't see it really bombarded with a lot of that, but you will see the names and places that may have influenced Walt in his early years here, but we really wanted to make an allusion to that so that you know, we're paying respect to those early years in every way that we can.
And as an example, maybe he did walk by Clarabelle's ice cream and brought his daughter Sarah and thought, Clarabelle, that's kind of a fun name. Or Fiddler Pfeiffer and Practical, of course, you know, for the cafe, and I think those are nice. You know, it's kind of almost chicken and egg too, you know, but that's okay, because these names are familiar to us as well, you know, and they have a certain resonance as well, so you're really going to enjoy that too, I believe. Yeah.
And we didn't really want to introduce a lot of characters into these spaces, mm-hmm. literally, because if Walt arrived in 23, they wouldn't have been developed yet, so... Mm-hmm. You know, we wanted to really respect that as well and be genuine with our story. So, yes,
best looking restroom facade of any of these in the park. So again, it's just like, you know, that's just one of the tile murals. I mean, and we've got tile murals at the guest services at the Los Feliz Five and Dime, and we went through a lot of work on those murals to get them right. And, you know, this is going back to the facade that was inspired by J.J. Newberry, but we totally redid it. But this again is the tool for every one of those panels that the arrow's pointing to. And then you can get a detail of right next to it. This is the Mortimer's Market. This is the open-air fruit market where you can go in and buy drinks and water and small items. But this is all based on that 6th Avenue shopping yard.
And we will have window graphics occasionally in some of the windows, so when we open, be sure to look for those. So that they'll also be part of our storytelling effort. Okay, this is fun. Our candy store, Trolley Treats, has a display window, and we're going to pay homage to an attraction that was never built, Big Rock Candy Mountain. It was designed for the site that Storybook Land occupies. It was a concept. You see the sketch there on the left. They actually built a model of it, which, as I understand it, pieces of it still exist, but at one time they were actually using real candy and frosting, and it slowly got eaten. So so that attraction was never built. I think that Walt decided against that. However, we're going to pay a little bit of homage to it in our candy store by building this operating model that is not a literal representation of the early design, but it's a metaphor. And the idea here is that it's 8 feet wide and 5 feet tall, and I think it's got some operating trolleys on it that'll be circling around. And I think it's every kid's dream. And our goal here is to have this kind of passive detail and display that as a small child or even as an adult, when you look at it, you dream, you won't forget it, and it'll be that kind of passive, iconic moment in the park that we all enjoy. It may not be a ride, it may not be a big attraction, but it's something that's fun to look at and something that pays a little bit of acknowledgement to our past. So we're pretty excited about this as well. It's currently under development. Lush landscaping. I think that's self-explanatory. Coulter's become a whiz at 3D modeling. So here's an example of his work. You can see we're standing next to Fiddler, Pfeiffer, and Practical, looking across toward Carthay Circle. And again, we have the largest oak tree that I've ever seen being imported into this spot. So I think we're understanding that Coulter's references to trees and sense of place. We are going to have shade, outdoor dining. The hub here is going to be a really wonderful place to just hang out and watch people and orient yourselves. I think every corner of the hub is going to be a place where, like the hub at Disneyland, you've got the opportunity to orient yourself, hang out, really get a sense of the geography and orientation of the park. And you combine that with the storytelling, the red cars going around, the water fountain trickling away. We think that this is going to be a heads and tails difference from what you experience today. Here's an early sketch of the fountain. It metaphorically is located in the same position as the fountain that we're building now, although it's not the fountain. We looked at several different designs here, and some of you may recognize the photograph on the right there. That's the Department of Water and Power fountain in Pasadena, and that we really like that from its period styling. So we started looking at some rough sketches of how we might pick this up and kind of use it as a tool between that and the Mulholland Fountain in Los Feliz to create something that's distinctly LA and distinctly Southern California and really give us a focal point for our new hub. And there it is under construction. You can see it. This photograph was taken last week. So it's behind the construction fence. It's not visible to guests, but we took a couple photos for you here, and you can see how it's starting to shape up. We have a lot of art tile inside, precast concrete, and this will really be a spectacular centerpiece to our new hub.
So you're seeing it here, but you're not going to see it when we open the hub back up for traffic to be able to get through there when we close the street down, because we're going to screen it off, so it'll be part of the opening day celebration when the street's actually open.
But he's not here. He saw it first.
You saw it first. Incomplete, of course. It's got a lot of brass, a lot of interesting ornamentation to it. So as it matures, imagine it circled with nice trees and beautiful street lights, and that'll be the centerpiece of the hub there. Another site photo. You see the fountain in the foreground, mid-ground left, and the tower that you can see above the construction fences there, the Carthay Circle Theater. And I want you to know that the Carthay Circle Theater is something that Coulter worked very hard on. I mean, he worked very, very hard with his team developing this design and coming up with
it. Had to sell it to project management first.
Yeah.
And, well, and, that's
all. That's another story. That's another story. But when you're coming up with a building that really serves as the linchpin of the hub and the focal point of Main Street, that carries a lot of weight, and it carries a lot of weight in terms of being a lightning rod for comments and suggestions. And I think. Coulter's done a masterful job of creating this edifice and really giving our park something that we can be very, very proud of.
One thing this slide shows pretty well, this is the existing Hollywood portal here. But what's really happening in a nice way is this little wall over here is part of the pump house, as well as the red car stop for the hub, that is actually part of the Carthay architecture. So now we have our own little portal to down El Camino Real. As you go through the hub and find your way down to the boardwalk or cars land, there's a nice little subtle portal we've created.
Yeah, the beauty of that is the pump house will also serve as a red car stop. So our trolley will the north end is, the north station is at Buena Vista Street, right at the Turnstiles. The next stop down the line is at Carthay Circle, where this pump house is. We're going to have a stop in front of the animation building on Hollywood Boulevard. And then the southernmost stop is down by Tower of Terror on Sunset Boulevard. So we have four stops, two trolleys running in opposite directions. So it's sort of like the horse-drawn trolley on Main Street. We've got a bypass, so the two cars will pass each other on Hollywood Boulevard there.
You can already see that the track's in.
And to Coulter's point, now... what was the existing California Adventure hub? When you looked south toward Paradise Pier, you could see the big tank at the tortilla factory. You could see the fruit stand that was down there by Bodine. You could see Paradise Pier. Here, when you look down the throat from the fountain to the rear of the park, we've got a visual block now, so you see a bunch of trees and you see the street winding down. But again, we've created another barrier so that we don't have this kind of overlapping lands that keep us from having a sense of immersion in the place where you would be currently standing. So we've solved that problem as well by creating this pump house and Carthay. Carthay Circle Theater. It's at the corner of the hub. I mean, I'm sure most of you have seen this rendering. What I will say about it now is that currently it's going to be the home of a high-end restaurant and lounge. And that will, again, serve as the focal point of Buena Vista Street. Do you have any other comments?
It's going to be a great place to watch the parades from the terraces. The parade route's being redone, and previously the stepping off point for the parade had been from behind Bugs Life Theater and coming around Sunshine Plaza and then proceeding out towards the boardwalk and pier area. Now it's going to be starting at Tower of Terror, coming down Sunset Boulevard, making a turn on Hollywood Boulevard, and coming through our hub between the fountain and Carthay, and then going back on the same path that it was previously. But that's going to create some great opportunities for viewing the parade on those terraces.
If you look at the rendering here, that building occupies the southeast corner of the hub, the southeast quadrant. The southwest quadrant is the pump house. The northwest quadrant is Fiddler, Pfeiffer, and Practical. And the northeast quadrant will be a park, but that will also be the home of the new Walton Mickey statue. If you look at the little study model that's on display here, you'll see that the Walton Mickey statue is at the front of Buena Vista Street by the flagpole. It's an early model. Since then, we've moved it back to the hub here, and we're going to have an unobstructed view of the statue here. And there's the Carthay Circle.
One thing I wanted to really reiterate is the Carthay Circle Theater does have, I think, a huge emotional impact, certainly to all of us at Imagineering, because of its significance in Walt's life. And as you know, when Snow White premiered there back in 1937, Walt had literally gambled everything on this one motion picture premiere. And he was quite nervous. Up until then, people had never really imagined that an animated film could be a theatrical production. They were usually, at the beginning of other movies. And the night, I can only imagine the night that he and Lillian were there at the premiere with the very first audience watching Snow White for the very first time. And then, of course, the reaction afterward made Disney who he was, or at least it furthered that. That's why we're all sitting up here today, and actually that's why all of you are here today. That one moment in time, you can certainly pick many moments in Walt's life that are very significant, but this particular one I think was certainly significant, and that's the homage that we want to pay, which was, that ability for him to show animated films to the world and have them embrace them as a medium and say, you're part of our life. Yeah. And then from there, this whole magic kingdom, was raised.
Here's a man who risked everything and pioneered so many things. Pioneered the first sound cartoon, first color cartoon. Mm-hmm. And then this animated feature that was Walt's folly, gambling everything. Yeah. And so that's a huge risk, a huge gamble, and I think to pay that off and to pay that moment off with the building that film premiered, its world premiere, as well as Skeleton Dance was in that same building. So there's it has a Disney history. Also, it was one of 14 theaters that had Fantasound installed when Fantasia premiered. So Walt Disney had a long-standing relationship with this theater, and we felt it was a fitting edifice to create. Here's a fly-through. You may have seen this in Tom Stagg's presentation yesterday, but we felt it was important to show it again. Up and around. And let's see. Ooh, there we go. And Coulter worked long and hard on this.
This is just an early sort of dissolve fly-through to show what the opportunities were for this facility in terms of how dynamic it was in terms of its location in the street and multiple levels of things that could happen here.
Yeah, to Coulter's point, the terraces will have premiere opportunities for parade viewing, and you can actually see the fireworks from Disneyland from the North Terrace. So we feel this is really going to be a great, great facility for us. The premiere of Snow White, Walt's arrival, partner statue in Disneyland. If you look at this statue, it's very monumental. This is Walt wearing a suit, as many of us know him as the more accomplished older Walt, sort of giving us this park with Mickey next to him on the pedestal in the planter. It's very monumental. Our Walt and Mickey statue at California Adventure is a little different because it's going to represent a young Walt Disney as he may have arrived in 1923. Although this is kind of an amalgam, the statue that we've designed, it's Walt and Mickey It's Walt with a suitcase and Mickey with a suitcase. So the traveling metaphor and the arrival metaphor is there. He's wearing a fedora. However, Mickey's with him, so Mickey may be his muse. This is sort of a metaphor. And the interesting thing about this statue is that we're placing him on the ground, on the sidewalk, with all of our guests, so that the metaphor is that if Walt Disney came to California to fulfill his dreams, he's just like the rest of us who have come to the park to live their dreams or come to California to live our dreams. He's one of us and we're one of him. So we didn't feel, with that story in mind, it would be appropriate to put him up on a pedestal as a monument. We want this person to be a living, breathing person who really is part of our world. So that's what we've done. And here's a couple of early concept sketches. There's a little detail. Here we go with some sculpting. We've got Marty, Rick Terry, some of the others there that were instrumental in developing that. And I have to apologize for this crazy slide thing, because once I press the button, it starts going through this routine. So let me see if I can. Jesus. They warned me this would happen too. So, so let me just let it play out. There it goes.
Get it quick.
Yeah, they get it quick. There are some sketches. So Marty, Melissa, that's the maquette. Now, the maquette is what the artist creates before they do the full-size sculpt. And the maquette is very accurate to the finished piece, although it's not exactly the finished piece, because at a smaller scale, you can only get so much detail. But it is very accurate and is the piece that the artist uses to create the finished piece. We had a very talented sculptor working on this, somebody who was a protege of Blaine Gibson for 30 years and has worked on the partner statue. And we're very, very fortunate to have him have worked on this. I guess I'd like to ask you guys a question now. We do have the maquette here, and I was wondering if anybody here would like to see it. Again, this isn't a full size.
Do you really want to see it? I didn't really. Oh, okay, I get it.
And I have to throw this in. I hope this isn't the wrong thing to say. I have seen the full-size sculpt, and it's brought tears to my eyes. And so I think this is something that is going to be very special to this park. And I would be happy to, if you'd like, lift the veil off of the sculpt, and you can take a look at it. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, let's do it. Let's do it.
So this is the maquette that you saw in the photographs, and that's what went into the full-size scope. So
when I say it was an amalgam, it is an amalgam. I mean, if you were to take a Walt Disney at a certain time and freeze that moment, this may not be it, because we've got, as I said, we've got Walt, we've got Mickey, we've got the suitcase with the graphics on it, and you know, some of these things are bits and pieces from life, but really, I implore you, when the actual full-size sculpture is unveiled at California Adventure, please take a look at it carefully, because it's got a lot of great detail and a lot of great storytelling, and I think it pays homage to a wonderful man with a wonderful life, and all I can do is just thank him for being who he was and who he was to us. So thank you very much. I think that's
thank you. Oh yeah, we wanted to tell you, thank you, John Rebecca. We had a little whisper. We wanted to let you know, probably within the hour, We're going to be moving this maquette downstairs to the Parks and Resort area, in the big blue curtained area where all the attractions are being talked about. And it will be down there for all of you to get a closer look at as well. So I want to thank you for coming here. We're very excited to be talking about Buena Vista Street. It's a whole new beginning, literally, and pun-wise, for Disney California Adventure. And it will be coming to you soon. And we are so excited that you could share this with us and see some things that no one has actually seen yet outside the little...
Outside of Imagineering.
Outside of Imagineering. So you're the first. And we're very excited.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Walt Disney Imagineering, thanks for joining us today in Stage 28. Enjoy the rest of your stay here at the D23 Expo, and be sure to visit the Walt Disney